You are watching And the Fouls Full Court Press. And now, here's your host, Nat. Where are you at?
Today I'm catching up with one half of the Cairns Taipans rookie duo, Cam Gliddon. Had a chat to Cam about his college life, how he's transitioned over to the NBL, and where he thinks the Taipans are at this year.
Cam forgot. Back door to Gliddon for the jam. Steinle goes baseline. Gliddon, after not catching it clean.
Pro life compared to college ball.
Well, I went to a small school in college, so it wasn't like you see on the movies, like the big-time schools, but kind of similar, except no schoolwork, which is definitely a plus, and people around town tend to know you a bit more, but yeah, pretty similar.
Yeah, cool. So how did coming over to Cairns, how'd that happen? Because I seem to remember hearing something about that Perth, I think, were chasing you for a bit or something, weren't they?
Yeah, during last off-season of college, I was back home in Perth, and I was working out a bit with their guys, and formed a bit of a relationship with the assistant coach, Sean Dennis. But, Cairns and Wildcats were talking to me, and I guess Cairns just felt like a better fit for me, and Mick Downer, who I went to the university games with, kind of persuaded me to Cairns, and that's how I went down.
Oh, okay, great. You're with Clint, like the other rookie. You guys are pretty much, I wouldn't say shoo-ins, but you two are probably, well, easily the best rookies this year. Have you guys talked about, you know, who's going to win Rookie of the Year, and have we got any inside bets or something?
No, we're pretty competitive at training with each other with shooting drills and stuff like that, but no, nothing like that. We're just trying to help the team however we can and get some wins.
Yeah, sweet. Where do you see the Taipans going this year? Do you think you're title contenders this year? Or?
Well, it's still early, so I guess everyone's still, you know, in the running for making that top four. We got a lot of work to do. We've still got a lot of gelling to do because we're a pretty new group, but I think if we get it together, we've got enough scoring power and enough defensive instruction from Fernie that can get us a long way.
Yeah, great. Have you been subject to any rookie duties or anything like that? Has Cam put you through the ropes?
Alex is probably the worst. Oh, yeah. I've got my own hat that has a helicopter.
Yeah, I saw that over there.
But it's not too bad. I actually forgot it one road trip, so they bought me another little teddy bear I have to carry around. But apart from that, not really, you know, just carrying bags and filling up drink bottles, things like that.
Has Clint been given anything worse, or is he getting pretty much
he's got
the
hat as well, but he remembers it every time, so he hasn't gotten anything worse, and I think we cop it about the same.
Yeah, sweet. So, growing up, because you're originally from Perth, yeah, aren't you? Who would you say, I guess, were your favourite NBL players growing up?
Yeah, I mean, I was a Perth fan growing up, before I went to college, and the AIS and stuff, I really liked, you know, Ricky Grace, Andrew Vlahov, those type of players, Aaron Trahair, his stint in Perth, kind of just the guys mainly that played my position, so Anthony Stewart, Ricky Grace, Aaron Trahair were the guys I like to watch.
Yeah, great. What about NBA? Did you follow NBA as well?
I was a pretty big Michael Jordan fan growing up, but because I moved over to Southern California, I ended up going for the Clippers, which was bit of a tough road for a while, but we're doing it right now, so it's pretty good.
Yeah, great. So who would you say, well, putting you on the spot a bit, but who would you say, I guess, is the top five NBL players of all time? There's been a lot of talk about it on Twitter, and it goes off and whatever, so...
Oh, wow.
Yeah, who would you say?
Five?
Yeah, top five, yeah. Well, top five imports.
Imports?
Yeah, we'll go imports.
Well, I only know what I know, but I'd say James Crawford's up there, just highlight reel. Ricky Grace was pretty good. I can't really think about I'm obviously missing so many great players. I can't think about
that. Yeah, that's wise. At the moment, who would you say is probably, I guess, the best or the better, one of the better NBL players to go against at the moment? Like, who do you find is been the hardest to guard so far?
Well, we've played some pretty good teams, and all the two guards that I match up against have pretty good resumes. You know, Ben Madgen's killing this year. He was a pretty tough cover, and Peter Crawford being a boomer. I guess every night's a pretty hard night. You got the imports with Wollongong at the two, you know, Lance Hurdle. So, every night's pretty tough. I wouldn't say one of them's tougher than the other. I just got to be on my best game every night.
Yeah, definitely. So, you went to college over in California. How did that originally come about? How did you make the move from Perth over to LA?
Well, I went from Perth to the AAS, and I stayed a year at the AAS, and from there, usually people tend to do 2 years at the AAS, but my year was the World Championship year, so I didn't really have anything to stay for. I wasn't going to play in the World Championships or anything like that, so really late, I kind of just wanted to go to college. I didn't really take a tour of the US or anything like that, and one of my AAS teammates, Ben Smith, went to Concordia, and Concordia's coach was really good friends with Randy Bennett at St. Mary's, so they kind of talked it out, and that's pretty much how I got there.
So when you finished college, was it always the plan to come back home, or were you looking to go to Europe, or?
I went to a pretty small school, so I wasn't that known. I probably wasn't even known back here to many NBL clubs, so coming back home was probably the main plan, and I think the uni games with Mick Downer kind of helped me a lot. I got to play a bit there, show that I could play international basketball, and that's what kind of helped me out the most.
Okay, great. Yeah, so being in the NBL, is it something that you'd see yourself doing for a long time, or do you think, you know, you're kind of going to maybe just, you know, do a year or two here and then see what happens? And
well, I'd love to travel around and play anywhere else, but I'm happy if I spend 10 years here, I'll be really happy with that. If I can go to Europe, because my mum and dad are both, one's from England, one's from Scotland, so I can get a passport to go, so that's a goal of mine, but if it turns out playing here is the best for me, I'm happy with that. Hi, I'm Cam Gliddon from the Cairns Taipans, and you're watching And The Foul TV. A little better. Yep. A little skateboard P.
Yes, sir. Week's blast in the past, we're going to go back and have a look at the old Sydney Supersonics. I was at a game the other day talking to someone in the crowd, and they had no idea the Supersonics even existed. Basically, the Supersonics were around from 1982 to 1987. After that, they merged with an old West Sydney team to form what is now known as the Sydney Kings. Owen Wells was actually the MVP that year. He came from the Sydney Supersonics. If you want any more info on the Sydney Supersonics, just head over to nblwiki.com.
This year, the first of them, Tiny Pinder, who was last season's top NBL point scorer, and a new recruit, now wait for his name, Derek Dot Pinder. He's fresh from the United States, as you'd guess with a name like that. Now, Dot is just a spot under 7 feet tall, and he's expected to give Tiny and the boys more than a spot of help on court this year. Hey!
Supersonics are an exciting team, and there's no member of the lineup more exciting or adept on the court than Tiny Pinder.
And Tiny Pinder takes it right past Jamie Kennedy to score.
Anything but Tiny, he's a former Harlem Globetrotter who really turns it on for the fans.
Pinder, turnaround shot, gee, he's really opened confidently in the second half.
Tiny has followed basketball all around the world. Although he's still an American citizen, for now Australia is home. He's happy here and considering staying.
My lifestyle is very quiet. I live a quiet life. I enjoy, besides basketball, it's going out to discos once in a while, playing a little tennis, lifting a lot of weights, building my body up and keeping my body in tune.
For Derek Dot Poker, the chance to come to Australia and play was too good an opportunity to pass up.
It's a lot of athletes over in the States, and it's not that many positions. But here, you get a chance to play, you get a chance to establish yourself, and you get a chance to see a part of the world which you've never seen before. So I look at it as a great opportunity, real good opportunity.
Until you've met Dot, you haven't seen tall. And Dot appreciates all 7 feet of his height.
Oh, I think it contributes a lot because a lot of people not used to a guy my height being there. If I can't block somebody's shot, I try to make a miss or change it up a little bit. And that's a valuable asset to our team.
The addition of Poker to the team will take some pressure from Tiny, who tended to dominate last season's action, trying to do too much.
Since we have a big fellow over here, he's going to take a lot of weight off me. That's where I can actually go ahead and do my job as far as like playing the game of basketball. And I hope that we will be able to win the whole thing this year. That's our goal for this year, is to try to win it all.
Winning the NBL crown is also in the mind of team coach Owen Wells, another American.
Well, my hopes for this season is, of course, the NBL championship. You know, I would like to see us attain that. I would like to see us just to be a competitive team, entertaining team. I think Derek's going to be very valuable to us. We have a very good team, and I'm basically looking for someone who could contribute, someone who's a very good person on and off the court.
Well, since this guy I've been here, he blocked my shot twice in training, so I told him I have to dunk on him to make him respect me. So that's, it's seriously speaking, it's really great having a guy like Derek.
The three Americans all live at the Metropole Hotel in Cremorne, one of the team's sponsors. The apartments are self-contained, so the guys can cook for themselves and live fairly normal lives. Lives devoted to basketball and training for the same. Despite the opportunities that Australia offers, Dot Poker had to make a big decision, leaving his wife and child behind in the States for what could be a lonely life here, making a name and money.
I miss him, but I try to keep things in perspective. I'm here to do a job and everything else to take care of itself.
Australia is just missing out when you compare basketball here to the sport in the States.
Success in Australian standards would be probably a few more venues like the entertainment center around the different major cities and getting them filled with people, I think, and national TV coverage. I think that's the key to it.
How important are the imports and the American influence on the Australian game?
I think it's very important because I think they show a type of basketball, a type of competitiveness and skills and fundamentals that a lot of Australian players haven't been exposed to.
There are other American-born players in the side, but they've assumed Australian nationality. But there are several fair-dinkum Australians also doing a great job.
We have some real good Australian players, and they really make our team. They really do. I was really impressed with them when I first came over here, the way they play, the way they act, you know, stuff like that.
The energy he used to go get it, and the energy you two used to go get it. The intensity level is different. See what I'm saying? He wants the ball. You gotta want it. You gotta bust for it.
The Supersonics will be busting for it all season in a team effort for the NBL title, spurred on by the Doc and Tiny.
But on the basketball court, we all are as one. And that makes a championship. That's why Brisbane won last year, because they were one.
Well, there it was. That's the Supersonics looking for a good year with some Americans, some very tall Americans on the side. That guy, Dot, what's his name? Dot Poker?
Dot Pinder, yeah.
Dot Pinder. He's just a touch under 7 feet.
Yeah, I thought Donnie McKinnon was tall, but obviously not.
Oh, geez, you leave Donnie McKinnon in the
dead, yeah.